with gratitude in your heart. Anybody grateful this morning? I'm grateful. I'm grateful. And not for something extravagant. I'm just grateful that I'm alive. I'm grateful that I'm alive and I'm well. Somebody online ought to bless God right now just for being alive and well. Can we just give God a praise for being good this morning? Come on, somebody just shout hallelujah. Hallelujah. Let's bless him this morning for his grace and his mercy. There's so much going on in our world, but God. But God, who is rich in grace and mercy, and we bless him on this morning. I'm glad to be here with you all. This is the Love Fellowship Church, the Kingdom Church, where Jesus is Lord. Our bishop is none other than Bishop Hezekiah Walker. What a great leader we have. And I'm just glad to be in the service one more time with all of you. Those of you that are here in the sanctuary, those that you are online with us, I'm just glad to have this moment with you one more time. Somebody say one more time. Come on, let's bless God. Father, have your way. Have your way in the service this morning, God. Move by your power and move by your spirit, God. Do something miraculous today, God. Somebody came expecting greatness on today, God, and we want you to exceed their thoughts, God. Exceed their needs, God. Do more than they expected, God. Hallelujah, like only you can, God. Put things together that were broken, God. Mend broken hearts, Lord God. Oh, God, heal bodies, set free and deliver. Have your way, God. Have your way, God. Have your way, God. We ask that you would have your way and we'll forever bless you. Somebody clap your hands and bless him. Come on, somebody clap your hands and bless him. This morning, what we want right now, with all that's going on in our world, somebody say it's dark. Come on, somebody say it's dark out there. What we need is the light. And we need the light that is none other than Jesus Christ. So this morning, we're asking that you all would find the light and walk in it. Walk in the light, the beautiful light. Come where the dewdrops of mercy shine bright. Say, walk in.
Walk in the light.
Beauty.
Beautiful light.
Come where.
Come where. The dewdrops of mercy. Of mercy shine bright.
Shine on. A beautiful light, come where a mercy shine bright and shine all around the sky by day. Y'all sound good this morning, choir.
Come where
a mercy shine bright and shine all around by day. Jesus, he's the light. Those of you watching at home, say, walk in the light. It's a beautiful light. Elder, come where,
yeah. Where the
mercy,
mercy shine bright,
shine all around
by day and by night.
Jesus,
he's the light of the world.
Let's go a little high. Say, walk in the light.
Walk in the light.
Beauty.
Beautiful light.
Come where. Lift your hands and say, shine on.
Shine all around
by day.
By day and by night.
Ask the Lord to shine.
Shine all around us. Hey. By day and by night.
Somebody at home, ask the Lord to
shine.
Shine
all around us.
Yeah.
By day and
now sing it up. Say, shine on.
Shine on.
Jesus said it's done.
It's already done. It's already done. And I don't know if you like me, sometimes I've been praying for stuff I prayed for a long time because I really want it to happen. But somebody say, Jesus said, it is already done. Now bless God like you believe it this morning. Yeah, yeah, hey, hey, hey. Come on, clap your hands, y'all. Now we're gonna praise him because he already did it. Y'all ready? Come on. Oh, hey, hey, hey. call upon the Lord. For he is worthy to be praised. And so shall I be saved from my enemy. And bless. And let the God of my salvation be the Lord. The Lord. is. Oh, yes, she is. Everybody say, there's only one. The Lord over my life, Lord over my life.
Praise the Lord, everybody. Everyone standing all over the sanctuary. I want you to give God a praise. If you know that He is the Lord over your life, if you know that He's Alpha, He's Omega, He's the beginning and He is the end, if you know that He is good and His mercy endures forever, I want you to open your mouth and give God a praise right where you are. Come on, Love Fellowship. Come on. Come on, He's the Lord over my life. He's my everything. He's the air that I breathe. He's the song that I sing. He is the first. He's the last. He's the beginning. He is the end. Come on, if you know that God is good and His mercy endureth forever, I want you to shout unto God with a voice of triumph and tell God how much you love Him. Come on. Come on, I can't hear you. I want you to tell Him how much you love Him. Tell Him how much you're grateful. He didn't have to do what He did, but He did it. And because of that, we owe Him a praise. Because of that, we owe Him a thank you. Because of that, we owe Him a hallelujah. And at the end of the day, my testimony remains, all is well. I dare you, look at your neighbor and say, all is well. I know what they said, but I also know what God said. And my testimony is, all is well. I dare you to put that down your row. All is well, all is well, all is well. All is well, all is well, all is well. One more time, put your hands together and give God a praise. While you're standing, let's thank God for the angel of this house. Let's thank God for our pastor, Bishop Hezekiah Walker. He's on his way. Look at your neighbor and say, neighbor, I'm so glad that you are here. I'm so glad that you made it. And I'm so glad that you're alive. That's the wrong neighbor. Look at your neighbor and say, I'm so glad you're here. I'm so glad you made it. And I'm so glad you're alive. And the fact that you still have breath in your body lets me know that God is still able. You're not saying nothing. The fact that I can breathe is a testimony that God is able. One more time, put your hands together, double time. And give God a praise. I'm so glad there's breath in your body. And I'm so glad that your life proves that the devil is still a liar. One more. Hallelujah. I said the fact that I woke up this morning proves that the devil is still a liar. That's a whole nother phrase. He's still a liar. At this time, we are going to receive our praise dance ministry. Let's put our hands together as they come.
Say, oh, how you tell me. And oh, how you tell me that I am your own. Let's say it real loud together. You know my name. You know my name. Hey. With you, and oh, how you talk with me.
Oh, how you talk with me.
Oh, how you tell me. And oh, how you tell me. I am your own.
I am your own.
Hey, somebody testify right here. Oh, so no fire.
Can we give God some praise? Come on, can we thank God that he knows our name? Come on, can you bless God for a Savior that knows your name? Amen. He knows how many hairs on our head we have. He knows our fingerprint. And there's nothing concerning your life that he does not know and he does not care about. So we celebrate him. Can you put some more energy behind that? Oh, come on, you can do better than that. Can you celebrate the fact that God really, before your mother and your father got together, you were predestined, you were ordained for this time, and we bless God and we praise God. Can we thank God for our praise dancers? Can we give God praise, amen, for our choir? Amen, all that has taken place thus far. Can we give God praise for the incoming of our bishop? Amen. Amen. At this time, we're preparing for our tithing and our offering. Amen. This is a significant part of worship. I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. Amen. I was glad for the opportunity to wake up this morning. Anybody celebrate God for just waking up this morning? Oh, he's the God of another day. Tell your neighbor, he's the God of another day. He is the God that will bless you to see what you don't even want to step in. And many times we feel like, oh, God, I don't feel like getting up. But I thank God that I've had the opportunity on this morning to stand and to breathe and to live. Amen. In spite of all of the calamity and chaos that's going on all over the world. Amen. The Lord has blessed you. The Lord has blessed me to be in the house of the Lord one more time. And when we come into his house, we don't just come, amen, just to receive. Amen. We come to give him praise. We come to give him glory. We come to give him honor and worship. And we are worshiping in our tithing and in our offering on this morning. Amen. We want everyone with your tithing, amen, to please stand. Everyone, please stand that is tithing on today. Amen. We thank God for all of you that are looking online. We thank God for you just tuning in, amen, to the Love Fellowship Tabernacle. Amen. The Kingdom Church where Jesus is Lord. Amen. And if you feel the need, amen, and you're an online member, you need to be tithing as well. Amen. Amen. So we want to make sure that we're giving God what belongs to him. Amen. The first tenth belongs to him. And he's given us everything else behind. Amen. God doesn't require much, so we want to bless him with this tenth. We're lifting our hand. We're lifting our tithing envelope. Amen. We're lifting our phone. Whatever means of giving, amen, whether electronically or whether manually in person, we're giving as unto the Lord. Amen. You need to just tell yourself that I am giving. Come on, repeat after me. I am giving as unto the Lord. Now, what that means when you say that, that means that regardless of every bill, regardless of everything that you need to pay, regardless of anything that your money has already claimed responsibility for, the first thing you're going to give is unto a God that needs, amen, you to trust him in your substance. So I'm giving it on today without any attachment, without any reservation, without any hesitation. I'm giving in spite of the fact that sometimes I don't want to give. But God doesn't bless you just because, amen, you don't want to give. He blesses you when you go the extra step and the extra mile. So we give it on today, lifting that a little higher, amen. Take the bend out of your arm. I'm lifting it unto my Savior and unto my Lord. Father, I thank you for this tithing that we're giving on today. It's not a debt that we owe, but it is a seed that we're sowing out of obedience. You said, here too, obey me with this, and see, won't I open up the windows of heaven, pour you out a blessing, God. We know, Lord God, that there are so many things that this flesh and this mind of ours desire to use our money for, but we give you this tenth. We believe and we trust that as we give this unto you, regardless of what we release, God, you will bring into our lives miracles, signs, and wonders. You will cover us and protect us. You will not let anything devour us or overtake us. And we trust you and we believe you. In Jesus' name, repeating after me, the Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not beg. The Lord is my shepherd. I will lend and I won't borrow. In Jesus' name, if you believe that, clap your hands, give God praise. Amen. Those clap hands, those hand clappings are a little weak. Amen. It's a little weak. Amen. Put some smiles on your face. Amen. I believe that every tither is an offering giver. And perhaps this wasn't your week, amen, to give your tithing, but it is always your opportunity to give an offering unto the Lord. It is always your opportunity. It's always your opportunity. Always your opportunity. Why do I say it's an opportunity? Because when we present something to the Lord, amen, in the Old Testament, they presented bulls and birds and turtle doves and all types of animal sacrifices unto the Lord. But in this day and time, we give him of our substance because this is our blood, sweat, and tears. So I want to challenge everyone that can and will to go the extra mile on today. I'm sowing a seed offering of $100, and that's not to boast or to be prideful, but that's just to be an example that I really trust God, and I believe that there are so many others in here that you trust God on that same level, and you don't mind giving a little extra. We normally ask for 50, or we normally ask for 40, But I believe in this day and time, amen, along with my life being consecrated, my finances must be consecrated unto the Lord. And so I'm giving, I have purposely given on today. No one asked me, but I believe the Spirit of the Lord prompted inside my heart, amen, to do so. I want to challenge each and every one of you that would do so, amen. Give something above the norm. Give something that is a consecrated offering, a sacrificial offering that shows God that I'm willing to go the extra mile. I just didn't come to do my ordinary. I just didn't come to do standard, but I want to go a little extra. Not that I'm even desiring anything, but that you deserve it all. Amen. I want you to stand with your offering on today. I'm challenging everyone that can get as close to that as possible. If you don't have it today, God knows the continence of your heart. Amen. We're not trying to push you to do something. I'm not telling you to rob Peter to pay Paul to give it, but I'm telling you, if you believe and you trust that God is a God that is worthy of an offering, of a sacrifice, I want you to do that on today. Amen. Lifting that offering in your hand, with no reservation, with no doubt. I know you have something tied to this that you're releasing in your hand, but I tell you, God already knew what you needed before you requested it. So if you learn to just trust them beyond the unknown, he will bless you beyond the unfathomable. He will bless you beyond you can ever ask or think. So we lift this. Wave your hand while you're lifting it. Wave your hand because we want to sign unto the Lord that we're giving it from freedom hearts. We're giving it from a free heart. We're giving it from a place of worship. We thank you for this offering that we're giving. Father, we lift our offering. We give you this praise. We give you this glory. We give you this worship with the finances that we've worked for all week long, the past 2 weeks, whether monthly. God, we release this unto you because we know that you're deserving of every offering. You're deserving of every sacrifice. So I release this unto you, God, not expecting anything, but just knowing that you're worthy of it all. You're worthy of all the glory. You're worthy of the worship from my lips. You're worthy of the worship, amen, from my feet and from my hands clapping and my feet stomping. But you're also worthy of me giving of my substance. You've given me this bread that I would not eat it, but that I would sow it into your house. Because we don't live by this alone, but by every word that proceeds out of your mouth. And as we release this, we know that you're a God that will release miracles, signs, and wonders. Bless your people. I pray over everyone that is giving an offering on today. I pray that there will be unrelented blessings coming your way. There will be no boundary over you. There will be no restriction over you. There will be no cloud over you. There will be no river over you. There will be no substance over you. Everything that is in your head, God, release it now. Every tie that's trying to bind you, every devourer that's trying to overtake you, every spirit that is trying to succumb you, as you release this offering right now, as you give God your praise in your with your substance, I pray that God release heaven's best for you now in Jesus' name. Come on, clap your hands. Come on, you can put your offering down for a second, but before we give this, before we release it, I want you to release a praise. I want you to open up your mouth and give God. Come on, let your lips match what your wallet is giving. Come on, yeah, that's it. Come on, let the volume of your mouth match the substance of your pocket. Come on, if you ain't got it in your pocket, lift up your praise a little higher. Come on, hallelujah, hallelujah. We give this unto you, unadulterated, nothing attached to it. God, we release praise unto you. Come on, in the balcony, come on the floor, on the soundboard, behind the camera, on the instruments. Come on, release praise unto him. God, you're worthy of glory. You're worthy of honor. You're worthy of praise. Come on. Release praise unto him. God, you know what I'm giving. But on top of what I'm giving you praise. I'm giving you dutiful praise. I'm giving you the substance of praise. I'm giving you the fruit of my lips. You're worthy. You're awesome. You're excellent. There is none like you, Father. We bless you, Jesus. We bless you, Jesus. We praise you now. Hallelujah. You can take your seat. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I feel the presence of the Lord in this place. I feel a move of God in this place. Hallelujah. Amen. Hand your tithing and your offering down to the nearest aisle. Our deacons are coming now. Amen. Our deacons are coming now. Amen. Josh, could you? Amen. Our deacons are coming. Amen. But can you keep the praise going? Can you keep the praise going? Hallelujah. 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 We bless him. We praise him. We glorify him. We release him to do what he needs to do. Come on, as you release your offering, you ought to release another praise. Come on, my whole body will be a participant in this worship. My hands will be lifted. My mouth will be open. My feet will be moving. Hallelujah. My mind will be thinking of the goodness of the Lord. Hallelujah. He's worthy of the glory. He's worthy. Amen. I believe everyone is giving. Can you stand to your feet and celebrate Jesus? Come on. Can we lift up our Savior? Come on. Lift up our Lord. He's worthy of glory. He's worthy of honor. He's worthy to be magnified. We bless him now.
Come on, we thank God. We are hastening to the word of God. You may have your seats. We wanted to do something very quickly because this is Clergy Appreciation Month. And we thank God for our leader. We understand that many of us have come from other walks of life and other reformations and churches. And some of our pastors before have become memory eternal. But we thank God for our leader, and we thank God for our pastor. So during this Clergy Appreciation Month, can we thank God for our leader? Can we thank God for our pastor? Can we thank God for his ability and his, come on, Love Fellowship, we can do better than that, his integrity. And Bishop, we want to say happy Clergy Appreciation Month. You may have your seats. One thing we know about Bishop Walker is that he is 100% integral. And he has the integrity to push the people of God. And we love him today. And we want to say thank you for everything that you've done for us. Thank you for your push. And this is my, I've been at Love Fellowship for 15 years now. And essentially, I came here with the preached word. I came here knowing that. And I thank God for that. But there is a space that you have taught me in terms of character. And I thank God. You can preach all you want to. But if you don't have the character to match what you're preaching, then it means nothing. So I want to say thank you for the character that you have taught us and not just me. So one more time, let's put our hands together and give God a praise. At this time, we're going to have a video presentation, and immediately following that, we're going to have a quick presentation from Pastor Battles.
Hezekiah Walker and the Love Fellowship Tabernacle Ministerial Alliance, we salute you.
Praise the Lord, everybody. Certainly today is a very special day, and we thank God that he has given us great leadership and that he has given us a man of God who not only loves us, but sacrifices for us. And Bishop, all the time, we thank you for your yes, but today we not only thank you for your yes, we thank you for your commitment. We thank you for your sacrifice. You teach us that love is what love does, and love is an action. So today, Bishop, we want you to know we love you. We love you. The deacons are coming. We have something for you, Bishop. We love you and we respect you so much. So we got some things for you to take with you today. Everybody, can you help me clap your hands? And we celebrate God. I need everybody in here to make some noise. Bishop, I tried to get your favorite things. But we love you and we celebrate you. And even though this is Clergy Appreciation Month, we appreciate you all year long. Clap your hands one more time for Bishop. And just before I take my seat, if all of the preachers can stand up, all of the preachers, all of you everywhere. Hospitality, if you can help me come. Preachers, we have something for each of you to say thank you. We thank you for your sacrifice. We thank you for your lifting up Bishop's arms. We thank you for accepting the call. And we just say thank you. Elder Keys, we thank you. Pastor Nate, we thank you. Elder Jones, we thank you. Overseer Clay, we thank you. Pastor Tanya, we thank you. Elder Wiggins, we thank you. Elder Langston, we thank you. Pastor John Manley, we thank you. Pastor Franklin Holt, we thank you. Evangelist Charmaine, we thank you. Minister DeMont, we thank you. So can you clap your hands one more time as we celebrate God's chosen? You can have your seat. And just before I take my seat, Bishop, I want to say personally, I appreciate you. When I came here, you made my transition so easy. And I'm so grateful for the love that I continue to feel. So today, I want you to know, Bishop, that it's my goal to make you proud. The stages I'm standing on are getting bigger. The places I'm going, they're getting bigger. The tables and the contracts I'm signing, they're getting bigger. And I say all of that to say, Bishop, is that it is because I am a seed from your harvest. So I want you to know that I will do my best to make you proud. I will do my best to make you proud. No matter how big the opportunity is, I will always make you proud. I love you, Bishop.
Can we all stand? It is time for the word of God. Man shall not live by bread alone, but every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God. Our bishop has been lent to the world, and he has been all over the world these last couple of weeks. He's been city to city, and he has not been home. But today, he is home. And although, come on, let's thank God for that. Although we loved all of the services that we've had, there's nothing like hearing from our pastor. I want you to put your hands together and give God praise for our man of God, our voice, our bishop, his grace, the Bishop Hezekiah Walker. Come on and give God a praise.
Praise the Lord. When I tell you, I am so happy to be home today. Oh, praise the name of the Lord. Now, it's one thing to celebrate me and to celebrate all of our preachers, but it's another thing to celebrate the one who woke you up this morning. Can you celebrate the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords? Come on, you got to do better than that. I will bless the Lord at all times. And his praise shall continually be in my mouth. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. Oh, give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good, and his mercy endureth forever. Amen. I feel now like Apostle Paul. Amen. In the scriptures, sometimes you would read that Apostle Paul always made mention of his church at Rome or either church at Corinth. And I feel like that because everywhere I go, I make mention of you. There will be no me without you. And so I celebrate each and every one of you this morning. Those of you that are looking and viewing from afar, amen. We celebrate even you today, amen. And we thank God for what he is doing in our house and in our place of worship. I want to thank God for the past few Sundays, how the Lord has ripped through this building. Come on. And I was watching online and I saw all of our young people being blessed last week. Amen. And even the week before last, I believe that God is calling revival for this house. Amen. So we thank the Lord for this time. And it's great to know that there's a group of people that know how to continue what we do. Amen. Even though the senior pastor is not home. And I'm glad that to know that God continues to move and to bless. And to all of our speakers who stood in this place and stood in my place to preach to you, let's give all of our pastors a hand. Pastor Clay, Overseer Clay, Pastor Langston, and all of the ministers and pastors who have come every week to hold up those arms who were preaching amen in my place. And I thank God for you. How many of you glad? Can you hold the music for just a second? How many of you glad to be alive today? I'm going to ask you one more time. How many of you are glad to be alive? Can you rehearse it out of your mouth? Come on, open your mouth and say, I'm glad to be alive and well. Come on, you better say it. That's a prophecy over your life. Open your mouth and say, I'm glad to be alive and well. Celebrate your life. Celebrate the fact that you are alive. Celebrate the fact that you are well. Thank God. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. I am alive and well. Make no mistake about it. So I honor the Lord. And to all of our mothers, and to you can stop that plate again. To all of our mothers and our deacons and all of our preachers and just everybody, our musicians, and all of our choir members, God bless you. Amen. We certainly honor you and we appreciate you. Amen. In the name of the Lord. The Lord is good, and certainly he is worthy to be praised. Amen. And I stand here, amen, with a few mixed emotions after hearing the passing of Pop Parker. Amen. And so we want everyone here on next Saturday morning, we want this entire church to be here, and let's salute, amen, his legacy. Anybody that know Pop know that he loved this church and he loved the bishop. I thought about him as I walked in and seen everybody standing up when I walked in. You know, Pop Parker started that. Amen. When I would walk in, he would come down that middle aisle and make, Bishop is here, stand up. You know, I'm not that type of pastor. You know, I'm like, I'm very low key. I don't require all of that. But it's wonderful when you can find someone that in that age bracket to look down and I'm a son to him. But although I was his son, I was his pastor. I was his bishop. And he reverenced me and reverenced the title. And so we're going to miss him. He would wait at that door for me, wait at that door for everyone. And so we're going to miss him. We're going to be praying for Mother Parker and the Parker family. So I need musicians. I need choir members. We're going to send Pop home correctly. Matter of fact, let me put it like this. We're going to send Pop home the Love Fellowship way. Amen. So we're going to have a great time in the name of the Lord. So we want everyone, amen, to be in place on next Saturday in the name of the Lord. We want everyone in clergy attire, all of our preachers, it's official attire for him. Amen. Official attire for him, and we'll be moving in the name of the Lord. I got to do this real quick. I have two more services to go to. Amen. How many of you are going to be praying for me as the Lord will bless us today? I want to call your attention as quick as I can to the word of the Lord found in Isaiah chapter 40, verse 31. I would ask you to stand, but you've been standing up for about, I sat there, y'all stood up like I was counting a one, two, three. This is a sit down, stand up church, you hear me? So I'm going to let you relax as I read. I'm going to stand up for everybody, okay? Amen. So Isaiah chapter 40, verse number 31. Isaiah 40 and 31. Repeat that, Isaiah 40 and 31. But they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings as eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. I want to talk to you from the subject this morning. Simple, just one word, wait. Look at about three people and tell them, wait. Wait. I think one of the most hardest things for all of us as believers is to wait. Sometimes in our waiting time, we get a little anxious, and sometimes we jump ahead of ourselves, and we also jump ahead of God. For a few weeks now, I know I told you all on Wednesday night we was going to start a new series. And I was going to start a new series today, but we're going to have to hold off until the Lord released me to start it, because all night long, I just kept hearing the Lord say, wait, wait, wait. So I woke up this morning and said, Lord, what are you trying to say to me, or what are you trying to say to us? And he simply answered me back and said, wait. And so as for about 3 weeks now, I've been teaching as I travel all over the world, between Africa, South Carolina, and back, and also Richmond and some other places that I had to go. I've been talking about living between miracles. And I think that's where all of us are today. Even myself, I'm living between miracles. I just left one miracle on my way to the next. How many of you in this room, you have left one miracle, but you're on your way to something else? Put a smile on your face. You don't have to be upset about that. Smile and tell somebody, I left one miracle, but I'm on my way to the next. Now, while you're on your way to your next miracle, I'm here to tell you, I don't want to frighten you, but you're going to reap havoc on the way. Because the enemy already know what you got, but he also know what you're getting ready to get. I need to talk to somebody in this room this morning that know that God got something greater than what he previously gave you. And when you know that something greater is coming your way, you don't sit in church with your arms folded or legs crossed. You don't sit there and wait for somebody to tell you to clap, or wait for somebody to tell you to get into the praise, or wait for the music, wait for the choir, wait for the drums, wait for the keyboard, wait for your favorite person in the mic. You don't wait for none of these things, because you know what God already spoke over your life. Now, I'm not talking to everybody right now, but for the 20 people that I am talking to, that God already told you that something great is coming your way, put a praise on what he told you. Can you do me a favor? And I know some of you have been waiting for a long time. And I know some of you have been praying and praying, and the enemy has been trying to shift you out of place. The enemy has been trying to make you to throw your hands up. The enemy's been trying to make you turn around and not believe God. But open up your mouth and tell your neighbor, I got something great coming my way, and I dare not move out of place. I dare not move, amen, ahead of myself or ahead of God, because what God is getting ready to do, and if God's going to do something greater than he did the last time, I'm staying in place. Oh, I need somebody to help me in here. Look at about three people again. Come on, help me. Say, if God is going to do something greater than he did the last time, I'm staying in place, because my last miracle almost made me lose my mind. I couldn't hardly believe what he did. So So while you know that something greater is coming, I want you to know that the enemy knows that something greater is coming too. So he will do everything he can to distract you from what's coming. He will distract you in your home and distract you on your job. And he doesn't play fair. He'll distract you right in church. He'll distract you in your prayer life. He'll distract you in your sanctification and in your holiness, because his mindset is to keep you away from what's coming. And he will detour you to keep you from the next miracle. As I was praying this morning, the Lord said, wait. And even me as a bishop and as your pastor, I have to be honest, sometimes my waiting period seems a long time. And sometimes when you wait a long time, sometimes you feel like it's not fair, especially when you see others that have not been waiting as long as you have been waiting. Especially when you see others who have not dealt with some of the things that you have dealt with. And it seemed like every time you look up, they got a big blessing. They got a big miracle. And you look at those who don't love God the way you love God, and not in church the way you love church and the way you do church. And sometimes, amen, your mind, and if you're not careful, amen, with your finite mind, you will start believing that God is not a man that will stick to his word. But how many of you know that he is a promise keeper? This time, don't talk to your neighbor, but talk to yourself and say, he is a promise keeper. He's a promise keeper. He's a man, amen, that should not lie, nor the son of man that he should repent. If he spoke it, he will bring it to pass. The only thing about our God is that sometimes he doesn't bring it to pass when we want him to bring it to pass. He doesn't bring it to pass when we think he should bring it to pass, but he brings it to pass on his time. And how many of you know his time is always right? I know his time sometimes seems a little late, and sometimes his timing seems a little backwards, but when he comes on time. He comes on his time. And so we have to understand that when we get to, amen, a particular space in the Lord, we understand that sometimes he doesn't come when we want him to come, but he does come on his time, and his time is the best time. Amen. So the Lord took me to King Saul, the first king of Israel. And as we view what's going on, amen, in Israel now, my mind went to the text, amen, where it talks about, amen, Saul now, amen, in trouble, amen, because the Philistines were now gathering to come up against him. He had now, amen, accomplished so much in Israel, and the people were happy that he was now their king. And of course, we always was taught, those of us, amen, how many of you went to Sunday school in here? Amen. If you ever went to Sunday school taught us that Saul was a people pleaser. Amen. And he pleased the people. And, you know, we kind of made immense spectacle of him, and we talked against him. But I want to talk about the good side of that and the good side of Saul, because sometimes people will paint you to be a bad person, but you're not really as bad as they would make it to be. You might as well say amen, because there's some people who painted you to be a bad person. And sometimes people will put the bad thing and bad word on you, but look at your neighbor and say, you're not as bad as what they said. I see some of you didn't say it, because you sitting there saying, yeah, I'm not going to say that, because you are something. But come on, open your mouth again and look at the same person who you did not speak to and just say, you're not as bad as what they have portrayed you to be. And so we have portrayed Paul, or Saul, in the church as a people pleaser. But when I think about it, no one wants to be in charge of a group of people and not want their people to be happy. No one wants to be, amen, a leader of a group of people, and the leader is the only one happy, and the leader is the only one satisfied. Amen. I view myself, I just don't want to be your pastor, amen, and I'm the only one walking around blessed. I'm the only one walking around happy. I want my people to be happy, and I want my people to be blessed, and I want my people to be pleased. Come on, y'all not saying nothing back to me. You should never want someone in front of you, amen, that will never make you happy. You should never want a leader. Let me just say this. You should never want a husband that's not able to please you as a wife. I need some wives to say something. You should never want a wife, brothers, that's not able to please you, amen, as a wife, and please you and appreciate you as a husband. So we must be mindful and we must be careful in this time and age to be around people that's not going to make it their business to make sure that we are happy. Amen. I'm to the place in my life now, whoever I'm going to connect with and whoever I'm going to be with, it is a main thing in my life at this point that we all have to look out for each other. I need you to help me talk to somebody. Come on, look at them. And I see y'all don't want to talk this morning. Amen. But tell your neighbor, say, neighbor, we're going to hang out. We got to help each other. We got to love each other. Come on, y'all ain't saying nothing. You got to make sure that I'm happy. I got to make sure that you're happy. Come on, y'all not saying nothing. And when you get blessed, you got to show me how you did it. Show me how you got it. If you find a sale, just make sure you tell me it was a sale. Don't try to make me think that you went to Neiman Marcus when you got it. Come on, when you got it somewhere else. Tell me the truth about it, because we all should be blessed together. And I'm to the place right now, amen, I'm tired of hanging around people, amen, that their peace is settled and my peace is unsettled. And how in the world can you walk together with somebody, you have peace, but your neighbor don't have peace? How can two walk together unless they be agreed? And you don't have to say nothing, amen, but I'm to the place in my life, and we're going to walk together, we're going to be blessed together, we're going to have peace together. Come on, you're going to look out for me, I'm going to look out for you. Yes, call me a friend pleaser, call me a people pleaser all you want, but I got to make sure that everybody is pleased with God. And I think that's what we're missing in the church. We have become so selfish. We have become so individualized until we're not concerned about nobody's happiness in Christ. We're not concerned about nobody else's peace in Christ. We're not concerned whether or not you're stabilized. We're not concerned that you're still living the way you were living 5 years ago. I believe that that kind of concern got to come back to the house of God. I don't believe that God will bless you and leave me behind. I believe that whenever God blesses you, he blesses you to be a blessing to somebody else. And I know you don't want to hear that, but open your mouth and say, neighbor, if God's going to bless you, he's only going to bless you so that you can be a blessing to somebody else. That blessing is not just for you, but it's for everybody that you are connected to. Everybody wants to be a millionaire. But how much of that money would you give somebody else that's in need? I ain't got nobody over here. How much of it would you give to charity? How much of it would you give to somebody in your church that know that you know that they're in need? How much of it would you give to your church? How much? But yet, your prayer is, Lord, turn me into a millionaire, billionaire, trillionaire. But what would your concerns be with all that you have for the people? Could it be Saul was concerned
about Israel?
Could it be
that he wanted Israel to be the best nation in the world? Could it be that he wanted them to be the best group in the world? Could it be that he wanted them to be like him? My aim and my goal is to have the best group of people following behind me. I would be less than a preacher to have, and my people don't have. I got about 5 people clapping. I'm prophesying to somebody right now, you just don't know it. Because basically what I'm saying to you, whatever's on me is getting ready to get on you. You see how quiet you are? Basically, I'm saying whatever God's getting ready to turn me into, he's going to turn you into that too. Basically, what I am telling you, when God raised me up, as a matter of fact, he's not raising me up, I'm already up. And I'm trying to tell you that wherever I am, God is putting you in the same position. I am telling you that God has allowed me to speak those things that are not as though they were. And whatever's on me, God got to put it on you. You see how selfish you are? You see how you don't believe it? You see how you ain't clapping? You know why? Because you're so individualized and you just want it for yourself. But whatever God put on you, he got to put on your son. He got to put on your daughter. He got to put on your husband. He got to put on your wife. Open your mouth and say, Lord, put it on me so I can put it on everybody else. This is why your kids ought to be grateful for having parents like you. I ain't got no parents saying amen. And I certainly don't have no kids saying amen. What the kids don't understand, whatever's on them was already on you. And because God put it on you, God put it on your siblings. God put it on your children. God, come on, y'all. God put it on your family. I want everybody to be proud about that. If you got anybody connected to you through your family bloodline in this church right now, look at everybody around you and say, you got it on you because it was on me. Come on, wherever they sitting at, point at them and tell them, you got it on you because it was. You see how you don't want to say it? Tell your husband, tell your wife, tell your children, it's on you because it was on me. Your mama might not be here. She might be in heaven. Your father might be in heaven. Hallelujah. You might not have your parents here, but everything you are, it was on your mama. It was on your daddy. And I know this is the Lord's service right now, but just for a half a minute, praise God for your mama. Praise God for your daddy. Y'all ain't saying nothing. Thank God. Look at your name and say, I thank God for my mama. I thank God for my daddy. I thank God for my grandparents. I thank God for everything that they went through. Because whatever was on them is on me right now. And I'm going to take this and I'm going to become successful. Could it be? Could it be that him being a people pleaser, he wanted his people to be as blessed as he were? Could it be that he knew that Israel was getting ready for the next miracle? They were living between miracles. Could it be that he wanted them not to be discouraged on the way to the next miracle? I don't know who I came here to preach to, but hear the words of your prophet. Do not be discouraged while you're on your way. To your... Do not be discouraged when you're on your way to your next miracle. Don't you know what's in front of you? Don't you know what God got for you? Don't you know what blessing that got your name on it? Look at your neighbor and wake him up. Say, this is no time to quit. Come on, say it again. Say, this is no time to quit. This is no time to leave. This is no time to figure out whether you're going to stay or whether you're going to leave. Whether you're going to backslide or whether you're going to stay in the church. This is no time. You are on your way. Hit somebody in the shoulder and say, you're on your way to your next miracle. This is why the devil is mad. You're on your way to your next blessing. You can't give up now. You can't leave now. You can't close your eyes and die right now. Your son is getting ready to be everything you prayed for. Your daughter is getting ready to become everything you ever hoped for. You can't give up now. I got 10 minutes here. You can't give up now. Please charge everything on your roll. Charge them right now. Say, we will not give up. I said, charge them. I said, charge them. That's not how you charge your row. You tell your row, we will not give up. We will not fold up. I don't care what happened. I don't care what's going to happen. We will not love fellowship. I'm talking to you as a church. I don't care what happened, what's going on. We will not give up. Can't. And so here it is. Saul is in a very, very strange predicament. He left one miracle, and the people were pleased with the miracle. See, you got to be very careful with people, because people will always be excited when the miracle hits them. But when they get used to the miracle and the blessing, and they want something else, and it's taking too long for them to get it, they'll become discouraged. In other words, whenever you get in the in-between, it's always good when you start out. Please tell your neighbor, say, it's always good when you start out. It's always wonderful when you start out. But when you get in the middle, when you get in the middle and become stuck, I need about 10 people that ever gotten to the middle. You saw your blessing in front of you, but you was in the middle and you was like, Lord, I feel like I'm stuck. I feel like I'm going around in circles and I feel like I can't get to it. I feel like I can almost see it, but I can't touch it. It seems like every time I try to get to it, I feel like I'm stuck. And you're trying to find everything that you can find so that you can become unstuck, so that you can keep moving. You just left one miracle, but you're on your way to the next. And you find yourself in between miracles. And you're discouraged because you got to do something. This is where Israel was. And this is where Saul was. They were stuck. He was stuck. And he started losing his people. He started losing his army. Because they was like, now wait a minute, king. You promised all of this. We just received the last one, but here it is. 90 and 80 days and we still don't have the next one. And you promised the next one. And little by little, his people started backing away from him. The Bible said that they scattered. Started backing away, and he was losing his army. Isn't it something how people would be with you when all is well and all is good? But real friendship is not being with me when everything is okay. Real friendship, come on, and real relationship is when things are all turned upside down. I ain't got nobody here. And they'll say, you know what? I'm with you all the way to the end. Do anybody have any friends like that? Y'all ain't saying nothing. I thank God for a few members like that that will say, Bishop Walker, I'm walking with you all the way. It looks dark right now. People got different mindset right now. People are scattering. People are not no longer here, but I'm walking all the way with you because I know there's another miracle that's getting ready to hit our church. There's enough. Anybody got any people in your life like that that will walk all the way with you? Tell somebody around you, I'm going all the way with this. Let's look at this. Go to 1 Samuel chapter 13. And I want everybody to look at this. 1 Samuel chapter 13, verse number 6. I got 5 minutes. Y'all help me here. I'm happy to be home. 1 Samuel chapter 13. Let's look at verse number 6. 1 Samuel chapter 13, verse number 6. Let's read the word of the Lord together. And when the men of Israel saw that they were in a strait, for the people were what? They were distressed. Then the people did hide themselves in caves and thickets and in rocks and in high places and in pits. Now understand this. Israel was under distress because the Philistines, however you want to call it, tomato, tomato, amen. The Bible says that they gathered together to come up against Israel and Saul. And the Bible said the army was so great until Saul's people began to hide in caves because they were nervous and they were scared. They were on their way to the next miracle and the enemy came. Listen, if the enemy is not on your trail, then that means that you don't have a miracle in front of you. If the enemy is not on your back right now, that means that you do not have a miracle in front of you. But everybody that every in this room, every time you turn around, the enemy is always doing something. I don't want you to sit there and be mad, but I want you to sit there and praise God because there's a miracle in front of you. Let's look at verse 7. And some of the Hebrews went over Jordan to the land of Gad and Gilead. And as for Saul, he was yet in Gilgal, and all the people followed him trembling. They followed him, but they were scared. They followed him, and they were trembling. Listen, can I say this to you? And I understand the text, and I understand the people, but while you're on your way to your next miracle, you have no reason to fear. I wish we can sing that song right now. Look at your neighbor and say, I have no reason to fear. Come on, the Lord is my light. The Lord is my light. That woman that is sitting here, that man that is sitting here, I come to tell you that the Lord have not given you the spirit of fear, but of love, power, and of a sound mind. While you're on your way to your miracle, don't worry about the enemy. Don't be trembling in your boots. Amen. Stand up, amen, and stick your chest out. Square your shoulders and tell the devil, I'm on my way to my next miracle. Do what you want to do, but I got power with God. Mess with my home, but I got power with God. Do me a favor. Look at your neighbor and say, neighbor, I'm not worried about nothing. I have no, come on, y'all better help me to preach. Open your mouth and say, I'm not worried about nothing. I'm not worried about what he's doing. I'm not worried about what he's saying. I'm not worried about what he's cooking up. I have no reason to tremble, and I have no reason to fear. I'm on my way to my next. I'm on my way. Look at verse 8. Let's go to verse 8. The Bible says, and he tarried 7 days according to the set time that Samuel had appointed. I want to stop here. He tarried 7 days according to the set time that Samuel, which was the prophet, had appointed. Samuel, the prophet, tells Saul, okay, go, you're on your way to your next miracle, and the enemy is probably going to come against you. But what I want you to do is I want you to go to Gilgal, and I want you to wait there for 7 days. And he said, within the 7 days, I'll be there. He said, within the 7 days, don't worry about it. I'm going to come, and I'm going to offer up a sacrifice, and nothing is going to go wrong. But I need you at my word, the prophet's word, get to Gilgal. Get there and stay there, and I will come within the 7 days. Got one question. Have anybody ever told you to go and wait and they'll be there, but they never showed up? I'm waiting for some answers here. One of the worst things that a father can do is tell his son or his daughter, I'm coming to pick you up, and have that child wait and have that child dressed and never show up. Verse 8 said, and he tarried 7 days according to the set time that the prophet Samuel had appointed. But Samuel came not. You look at it, he came not to Gilgal. And the people scattered from him. The people said, like some of us probably would have said, oh, the prophet ain't here? I'm leaving. Like some of y'all do when y'all don't see my truck in the parking lot. Oh, Bishop ain't here, I'm out. Oh, Bishop ain't coming tonight? No, I can't do that. It's quiet. Bishop said he was going to be here today. Where he at? Who preaching? Overseer? I don't want to hear overseer today. Eric again? I'm trying to help y'all. The prophet didn't show up. And the Bible said, Saul's people said, I'm out. You said the prophet was going to come within 7 days, but he's not here. Philistines is right there. They getting ready to kill all of us. I'm out. Let's go to verse 9, everybody. And Saul said to the remaining group, bring hither a burnt offering to me. Bring a peace offering to me. And I'm going to offer it up as a sign of peace against our enemies. Look at verse 10. And when it came to pass that as soon as he made the end of the offering, the burnt offering that was, or that is, behold, here comes the prophet. Isn't it something when you need people, they're nowhere around, but after you go through what you go through, they show up? Here comes the prophet. Now look what Saul did. The Bible said, and Saul went out to meet him that he might salute him. See? He went out to meet him that he might salute him. The prophet didn't show up, but he still had respect for him. Oh, I wish I could stay right there, but I got to get out of here. I don't care what happens in your life with your parents or with people who have guided you, with your pastor, with your leaders, and you feel a little indifferent because they did not show up when you wanted them to show up. Respect is still due. Y'all ain't saying nothing. If I never remember your birthday, if I never remember your name, y'all ain't saying nothing because my age is catching up on me and some name skips my mind at times. So sometimes I got to say sweetheart. But sometimes, amen, if your name escaped my memory, if I forget your birthday, if I forget to say hello, respect is still due because I'm still your pastor. If I preach something and step all over your toes, if I preach something that shifts you out of place, I'm still your man of God. I'm still your pastor. Just take it and say, ouch. We're living in such a strange time where people say, listen, he's my pastor, but he better not move me the wrong way. He better make sure he preached something that I like. My job is not to preach everything that you like. Sometimes I'm going to preach something that's going to get on your nerve. Sometimes I'm going to preach something that's going to make you, oh, y'all not saying nothing. That's going to make you get your heart right. That's going to make you examine yourself. But still, that's no reason for you to disrespect. Shame on every member. And I'm not talking about this church, because we don't deal with that, at least not right now. But shame on every member, and I'm talking to the camera right now, for those of you, amen, that belong to other people's churches and belong to your pastor's church, and when you get mad and when things don't work out your way, you blast your church and blast your pastor on social media. Shame on you. You're supposed to always salute your pastor. Shame on you to have conversations against your man of God. Conversations against your pastor. Oh, I'm preaching hard today. I can feel like I'm talking about somebody up in here. But you have time to repent right now for talking against your man of God. For getting on conversations and talking about your church. And talking about what you don't like. And what you think should happen. You ain't the pastor. God told you to follow, not lead. Y'all ain't saying nothing. Paul told the church, follow me as I follow Christ. And if you don't like, y'all ain't saying nothing. And if you don't like what's going on, then you can't be in leadership. Take off your title and sit down. Take off your title and stay home. Because y'all ain't saying nothing. Because for everyone that leave, God gonna send 2 or 3 people up in here. And if you don't get rid of that spirit, the next church you go to, you gonna have that same spirit at your next church. The Bible said that, now let's be honest, he had every reason to be mad at the prophet. He had every reason to be mad at the prophet. Because the prophet said, I'm coming, and didn't show up. His men started scattering. And he was almost left by himself because the prophet didn't show up. But he had every reason to be mad at his prophet, mad at Samuel. But the Bible said he ran out to salute him. Because he's still God's man. Tell everybody around you, say, I'm still God's man, still God's woman. Be careful. Huh? You know how many times I was upset with my mother, but she was my mother. Couldn't disrespect her. You know how many times I felt that my mama was wrong, but my mama looked at me and said, who's the parent here? I need somebody to say here. Huh? Who's the mother here? Huh? And my mother said this. I don't know if some of you young people get away with a lot of stuff. My mother said, listen, when you're that grown and you don't want to respect me and listen to me, get out and buy your own clothes and buy your... I need some parents to say something up in here. But as long as I'm paying the rent and as long as I'm the mother, you're going to follow what I'm saying. And here I am 60 years later. I'm so happy I listened to my mama. Anybody in here happy that you listened? Anybody in here did not listen, but you paid a hefty price? I'm not going to stand here and act like I didn't. I always listen because I didn't. Huh? Huh? I promise you, the times that I didn't listen, I paid a hefty price. Huh? My left arm is broke right now, still broke. Because I didn't listen. Every day. Huh? It's still broke. Still broke.
I ain't gonna tell y'all, show y'all. Because y'all didn't know me. It's still broke. Because when I broke it, I wasn't supposed to go outside. And I waited till she went to church. And I said, I'm going anyway. Went outside, fell down a flight of stairs. And now I landed on my hands. But it was too much weight. And this arm bent. And so my sister's trying to cover it up because she said, listen, you don't broke your arm. We all going to get a whooping. Because see, that's the time I grew up in. Whoever was in charge, if they didn't do what mama said, everybody got in trouble. So my mother, so my sister by herself said, okay, listen, I'm going to take you to the hospital and you better not tell nobody. So my sister took me to the hospital real quick and we said, oh, service is going to be over in about an hour. So my sister runs in the house and said, listen, you got to do something to my brother's arm because listen, my mother going to be home from church. So they took me in and so the doctors, I remember the doctor saying, listen, we got to re-break the arm. So the arm, doctor said, now back then it wasn't, so I said, now either you want us to put the cast on like this or we can re-break him. I said, don't re-break it, just put the cast on. Put the cast on. She said, now you're going to have to cover that cast. I walked around for weeks like this in my house. I promise you. My mother said, why you keep walking around? I broke my arm. And they never reset it. So the arm was still bent. And it's still bent today. If you ever notice, anytime I ask you, and anytime you give me something, now I'm left-handed. This is the hand that was broke. But every time you hand me something, I have to get it from my right hand. Because I can't completely turn my left hand, see? It don't turn like this. Because it's still broke. And it's always a reminder of my disobedience. It's a lasting repercussion of my disobedience. And some of you are paying a hefty price right now because you will not obey. Scream real loud and say, wait! Let's go to verse number 11. Go to verse number 11. Verse number 11 says, and Samuel now comes after he makes the sacrifice. And Samuel says, what has thou done? What did you do? What did you do? So Samuel looks back at him and says, because I saw the people was leaving. Look now. Because I saw the people was leaving, they were scattered from me, and you did not come on here, within the days you appointed, I had to make a decision. God help us, Lord. I had to make a decision. And so this is where we point the finger at Saul. And we say that Saul was a very disobedient king. And he did not follow. And he did not do what he was supposed to do. And this is where his disobedience come in at. But I want you to draw your minds in for just a little bit. Just a little bit. If the enemy was about to blow your whole home up and your family up, and you were waiting for the prophet to come to stop the enemy from killing your family, and the prophet never shows up, and your first mind is, the prophet told me to wait, but my family getting ready to die. Before you get mad at Saul, think about you for a second. What would you have done if your firstborn son
and your daughter was about to die, and your husband was about to die, or your wife was about to be beheaded, and all you had to do was offer up a sacrifice, and they would live. What decision would you have made? We call it situational ethics. For those of you that are writing, write that down. Look that up when you get home. Everybody say situational ethics. When you got to make a decision and it's not 100% right and it's not 100% wrong, but it's ethical. Now, quickly, where am I? I'm 10 minutes over. But don't sit here like you have never been in a situation and you had to make a quick decision. Although God told you to wait. Although God told you don't make a move. But it was a situation. It was a situation. And sometimes you have every right to make a situation when somebody made you a promise that they didn't fulfill. The prophet said, I'm going to show up, and he didn't. He came a week later. He shows up 7 days late. Shows up 7 days late. Now, that's another sermon. Because the question is to all of my preachers and theologians, why was he late? We'll talk about that probably next week. Why was the prophet late? Why did he come late when he knew the Philistines was coming? Huh? Why did the prophet come late? Again, we'll talk about that next week. But he was late. And the Bible said that Saul made a decision to send this burnt offering up to cease the ambush. Play something soft. Cease the ambush. I want to say to you, those of you that are in an ambush situation, you're in between miracles and the enemy has launched war against you. I know it was the ethical thing to do. I know Saul did it on impulse. Saul was looking out for the people and himself. But the Bible says, wait. Wait upon the Lord. Now, I gotta be honest, in your waiting time, you might lose a few things. You may lose some things, but you're gonna gain everything. I need a better praise and clap than that. Go back to the scripture in Isaiah. I know you're going to lose a few things. How many of you in this room ever lost a few things in your waiting time? Come on. Tell your neighbor, I lost a few things in my waiting time. You're going to lose a few things in your waiting time, in that waiting process. You will. But if you wait on the Lord, it's Isaiah. I need them, Isaiah chapter 40. Verse 31, Isaiah 40 and 31. You're going to lose a few things in your waiting time. People are going to scatter and they're going to walk away from you. People are going to be nervous like we're waiting and nothing is happening. We're waiting and people are leaving. Are we really going to get a new church? Are we really going to change things?
is God going to give us that blessing? Are we going to ever get to the next miracle? It was a miracle getting this building. But Love Fellowship, don't you know that there's another miracle with our name on it? We've been waiting. Bishop keep telling us to pray. We got the 21-day fast, the 21-day shut-in, all that. We're doing all of this, and still, we're still waiting. But they that wait upon the Lord shall what? They shall renew their strength. They shall mount up on wings. Don't you know while you're waiting, God gonna give you some wings? They shall mount up with wings as what? An eagle. Huh? They shall what? They shall run and not what? And they shall what? Walk and not fall. Wait! I say on the Lord. Wait, I say on the Lord. I want to be transparent right now. Seriously. Because I think all of us, could you play the keyboard too as well? I need to hear that and something else. Wow. Thank the Lord Jesus. I need to hear everything. This is a very important moment for the believer. Hallelujah. What key is teach me how to wait in? Well, play it in any key. Patience is a virtue I desire. I need it when I have to go through fire. When you say no, it tells me what not to do. And when you say yes, I know you'll see me through. Waiting is a simple thing that we must learn how to do. Teach me. Everybody teach me. How to. Can we do it again, everybody? Listen. Patience is a virtue. Tell New York I'm coming. I desire. Everybody. I need it when I have to go through the fire. Come on, play. When you say no, it tells me what not to do. And when you say yes, I know you'll see me through. Hey, waiting is a simple thing that we must learn how to do. Teach me, church. Teach me. Say, Lord. Come on, y'all clap your hands and say, teach me. Say, Lord, teach me, say, Lord. How many of you want to learn how to wait? Say, teach me how to wait. Teach me how to. How many of you want to learn how to wait? Wait. 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 Teach me how. Come on, ladies. Somebody say, wait. Teach me how. Everybody say, wait. Say, wait. I need to hear y'all. Wait. Teach me. Teach me how to.
Here we go.
Clap your hands, everybody. I done turned you on to a choir, huh? Stay right there. Everybody that really need to wait, I really don't know who I came for today, but wait. The promise he made to you about your son, wait. The promise that he made to you about your marriage, wait. The promise he made to you about your family situation, wait. The promise he made to you about making you a lender and not a borrower, wait. I know what the doctors have said. I know the doctors have given you a bad negative report. But if you wait on Jesus, hallelujah, when it looks like it's over, wait on the Lord. 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 It's hard, but wait. It's a struggle, but wait. Wait on the Lord. Wait, I say, on the Lord. Those of you that are struggling in your waiting time, don't be ashamed. But if you need prayer, can you run to this altar right quick, please? If you're struggling in your waiting time, it's all right. Come with me to this altar. Come with me if you're struggling. Come on. I'm struggling, Bishop. Come on. I'm getting impatient, Bishop. Come. While they're coming, clap your hands. Come with me. While you're clapping, are you going to clap for these that are coming this way? I'm waiting. Bishop, I'm waiting. I'm waiting. Come on, y'all. Keep playing. I'm waiting. Look at all these are coming to the altar today. Hallelujah. Yes, Lord. Thank the Lord. Yes, Lord. Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. Jesus. Listen to me. If I did not come here for no one else, I came here for you today. I didn't even know you were going to be here today. But this message is for you. This message is for your family. I want you to wait and be of good courage. While God is healing your body, hallelujah. I know it's difficult, and sometimes we don't know why things happen. But sweetheart, sometimes things happen for a reason. And when I tell you that God's going to give you a testimony, when I tell you that God is going to give you a major testimony, eyes have not seen. Now, you walking in here today is a miracle. The doctor said it would never happen. Go!
I got to get to New York, but the doctor said it would never happen. And right now, you are on your way to your next miracle. But I'm here to tell you that you are going to get to the next miracle come hell or high water. Everyone that have come down to this altar today, I don't know your situation. I don't know your problem. But can I tell you to wait on the Lord and be of good courage? He's going to strengthen your heart. You're going to mount up with wings as an eagle. You're going to run and not be weary. You're going to walk and not faint. Get ready, because you're going to run again. You're going to come in this church one day without any kind of assistance. Anybody believe that? Anybody out there believe that in this room? Lift your hands, everybody in this room. Those of you that have come down, Father, in Jesus' name, teach us how to wait. If we wait on you, we believe that things will work out in our favor. Father, in Jesus' name. Those that have been waiting, encourage their hearts now. I want to say this while they're praying and their hands are up. Sometimes people can seem to be strong, but yet they're weak. Father, strengthen those that are weak now. We're doing our very best to try to hold on. But Father, give us the strength to believe you in the midst of what's going on. Father, I pray in Jesus' name that you would send healing to the body. Refresh the heart and mind and soul. Send encouragement to every man, woman, boy, or girl in the name of Jesus. All the days of my appointed time will I wait until my change come. I need everybody that have come down to the altar. I see some of you crying and some of you, but I promise you, those are not tears of sorrow. Those are tears of joy, because God is putting patience in your spirit now. And you're going to wait on the Lord like you have never done before. Everybody that believe that God is going to give you the spirit of wait, and God is going to put waiting in your spirit, I need you to clap your hands and give God the biggest praise you can now. Come on. Your helper. Hallelujah. Wait on the Lord. Wait on the Lord. Wait on the Lord. Come on, everybody, clap your hands all over here. You wait. I promise you, God's going to do this thing. I promise you. Thank God. Those of you that have come down to the altar, encourage each other. You're not going to scatter. You're not going to run. Everybody that came to this altar, hug somebody else and tell them, we're going to wait. Come on, hug somebody and tell them, we're going to wait on God. Come on. Everybody in the audience, find somebody, hug them and tell them, we're going to wait on God. Come on, we're going to wait on God. Come on, say, we're going to wait. Come on, tell them, we're going to wait. See, why y'all not helping each other? Stick together with this. Come on. Come on, tell them, we're going to wait on God. We're going to wait. Come on.